So here we go with the second week with the practice of a varied tradition with many different groups or denominations. And I picked out some basic practices which I feel are common to all groups, but some groups are going to emphasize one thing over another. And so these I will speak about: the reading of sacred scripture, prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. Rituals of the church, called by most Christians either sacraments or ordinances, calendars and saints and pilgrimages, and lastly, the pealing of bells. So this is a picture of the Bible that is sitting on my desk, the reading of scripture of both Old and New Testaments is an essential part of the Christian tradition, and the use of it in worship services as well. Scripture texts are often cited in sermons, and selections from scripture are read in worship services daily and weekly. So scripture pervades all of Christian teaching and Christian practice. And also private reading and study, group reading of scriptural texts, and even recitation are encouraged. But I will tell you that Roman Catholics don't recite scripture terribly well. We sometimes will just know where to go and find it. That's not always true, but I know that others, like our Baptist brothers and sisters, really, really study sacred scripture, and they're to be commended in that regard. We study scripture, but probably not as good as reciting and practicing it. So another activity in Christianity: prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. And this is a figure of one of the early Christian catacombs of St. Priscilla in Rome, and it is a figure of a woman praying with her arms being held up. This was a common prayer posture in the early Christian church. And this is a quote from the Gospel of St. Matthew. Jesus says, "When you give alms, do not blow a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets to win the praise of others. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right is doing, so that your almsgiving may be secret. And your Father who sees in secret will repay you. When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites who love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on street corners so that others may see them. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go to your inner room, close the door, and pray to your Father in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will repay you. When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. They neglect their appearance so that they may appear to others to be fasting. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face so that you may not appear to others to be fasting, except to your Father who is hidden. And your Father who sees what is hidden will repay you." So we see there the three traditional disciplines of Judaism, of the Jewish tradition, ahead of Jesus, but Jesus carries them forward and says, this is important for you as well. But when you do it with honesty and integrity, not just to show off, because that gives you nothing. Prayer, fasting, almsgiving are important aspects of the Christian tradition as well. And in the aspect of prayer, it implies here that perhaps that you just go and be private in your prayer, but of course we know that there is public prayer in Christianity as well. And the worship services and all public prayers are very common in the Christian faith. And this posture of the figure of the woman holding up her hands is still common in some Christian traditions, although many others would not do that. And also, standing is a very common prayer posture for Christians, as is kneeling. sitting to listen to words of scripture or listening to a sermon, and sometimes even prostration. We know that our Muslim brothers and sisters prostrate often. That is particularly in Eastern Orthodoxy and Roman Catholicism, one of the prayer postures for the congregation or our ministers to actually prostrate. So this is a picture of me back in 2015. I was in the catacombs of Dom Attila in Rome and offered mass there in the catacombs. And I'm going to talk briefly now about some of the more common rituals of Christianity, called by many Christians sacraments, or they may also refer to them as ordinances. There are three rituals of initiation into the Christian community: baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist, also known as communion. And when a person becomes a member of the Christian community, whether they are an infant or whether they're a little older, they usually receive these rituals in this order. They are immersed, or water is poured over their head, and they are baptized. Baptism comes from the Greek word that means to immerse. Confirmation, usually with imposition of hands and anointing with oil. And the Eucharist, of course, the sharing of blessed bread and wine, consecrated bread and wine, which many Christians receive as the body and blood of Christ. Others see that in a more symbolic or representative way, but so there are different ways of interpreting it. The service on Sunday, usually referred to as the Sunday service. Catholics would call it the Mass. The Orthodox churches of the East would call it the Divine Liturgy. There are rituals of healing, going to a priest or a bishop to go to confession for counsel and admitting their sins and receiving a blessing of forgiveness. And then also for those who are sick, oil is placed on their forehead and on the palms of their hands for healing. Also in Christian tradition, marriage is also very much a part of the tradition, as well as ordination to ministry. And there are three traditional ranks in the ministry: a deacon who assists the priest or the elder, and the bishop who is the leader of a local community. The word priest comes from the Greek word presbyter, which means elder. And there's also in Christianity, particularly in the Catholic Church and the Orthodox churches, but also in the Anglican Church, men and women who have, since the early centuries of the Christian tradition, created communities that live, work, and pray together, and they're referred to collectively as monks and nuns, and that would be a particular style of living the Christian life in community, okay? I know I'm trying to fly through this, but as varied a tradition as it is, there's lots of things involved, so the Christian calendar is another aspect of church life, and you see there an overview of the calendar, and the central point of the Christian calendar is Easter Sunday, the day of Jesus' resurrection from the dead, and it is the first feast that was celebrated in the early church, and it is still considered the greatest feast of the Christian calendar. And if you look back in the wintertime, Christmas is another, the feast of the birth of Jesus on December 25th. And there are preparatory seasons for each of those great feasts: the season of Lent, which is a season of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, precedes Easter Sunday, as the season of Advent precedes Christmas. And the calendar goes around as well through a period of time for Easter. There's a 50-day period for Easter, ending in the celebration of the coming of the Holy Spirit, Pentecost. And then the rest of the year, going back to the beginning of Advent, is Sundays after Pentecost, or as the Catholics call it, Sundays in ordinary time. And not every Christian community has the same kind of calendar, but the Catholics and Orthodox and High Church Protestants, as we would call them, those who follow the calendar, would follow this or something very similar to it. A Baptist minister is free to come up with his own services and readings and everything. They're very independent. So, like I said, there's a lot of range of interpretation and understanding about how to live the Christian calendar. Many of the Christian denominations regard to saints commemorate various saints on their calendars, often on the date of their death. Why focus on saints? For the very reason that Christians look at the saints as heroes, and they seek to imitate the virtues of those saints who have gone before them. And some prominent saints' feast days, the passing of the Virgin Mary, also called the Dormition or Assumption of Mary, on the 15th of August, the Feast of St. Joseph, the foster father of Jesus, the 19th of March, and St. Francis of Assisi, a great medieval religious leader, and who visited the Sultan of Egypt. His feast day is the 4th of October. And I put a figure there of the Virgin Mary. This is probably one of the oldest images of Mary in existence, from the catacombs of St. Priscilla in Rome. And that probably goes back to around the 3rd century. So that's very, very ancient. So I just included that as to illustrate the point about the importance of saints in the tradition. Also, there's an image of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, which is the traditional site in Jerusalem of the death and resurrection of Jesus. And that church is very unique, for many different Christian denominations all worship there. Sometimes when I was there, for example, it was very noisy because the different groups were going around and doing their prayers and devotions, excuse me, at the same time. And so it's a place of great pilgrimage. And I mentioned that in this statement here, that pilgrimage is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, Lourdes in France, a shrine dedicated to the Virgin Mary, and Compostela in Spain, which is dedicated to St. James the Apostle. They are destinations for many Christians who would go there and pray. And particularly in the Compostela devotion, part of the important and central part of that is the traveling to get there. So that Compostela in Spain is really the final destination, but it's the journey itself that is important. And the other places mentioned here are sites in and of themselves where people go and pray and reflect on the mysteries of their tradition. And much like Muslims who go to Mecca during the feast of the pilgrimage there for the Hajj, a Christian might go to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, for example, there to pray and to worship. So, the use of bells, and I found this in a note here, that bells go back to about the 5th century. An Italian bishop, Paulinus of Nola, introduced bells as part of services. And in the 7th century, the Pope officially sanctioned the ringing of church bells during worship. And the bells became a common way to announce times of daily prayer called the canonical hours. And by the Middle Ages, church bells were common in Europe. So we have our own bells, and I hope this works. I'm going to hopefully play our bells pealing here at Our Lady of Prompt Succor Church in West Wego. And Much like the muezzin and the minaret calls Muslims to prayer, the bells call the Christians to prayer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Father Badi Abi. It is not easy to speak after Badi Abi, I know that. And let me share my desktop first. Yeah, I hope you see my desktop right now.
Yes.
Okay, great. So, last week, as Richard Tabe told, we talked about Islamic faith. I talk about Islamic faith. And there were six building blocks of Islamic faith. These are belief in God, belief in the day of judgment, and the life after that. Belief of the holy books, belief in prophets, belief in angels, and also belief in the divine decree. So this week, we will, on this foundation, we try to figure out the Islamic practices, how Muslims practice, what they do in their daily lives. And I will format this week, divide this week as two. First, I will talk more about ground practices. I can name them as ground practices. And I will compare that ground practices with 10 commandments, which you can find in Old Testament. Then I will come to delve into the five pillars of Islam. And when you delve into you will realize that how similar our practices looks like, basically. So again, I set up a presentation, a lecture room for you, and we have six folders on our table. So let's start with the first one. I'm sorry. Yes. So before delving into the five pillars, let me kind of read the two sections in Quran and comparatively analyze this Quranic section with Ten Commandments. So the first section is in chapter 6 of Quran. Let me read the whole two verses in this chapter. Say, come, I will recite what your Lord has prohibited to you. He commands that you not associate anything with him, and to parents, good treatment, and do not kill your children out of poverty. We will provide for you and them, and do not approach immoralities, what is apparent to them and what is concealed, and do not kill the soul which Allah has forbidden to be killed, except by legal right. This has he instructed you that you may use reason. And do not approach the orphan's property except in a way that is best until he reaches maturity, and give full measure and weight in justice. We do not charge any soul except with that within its capacity. And when you testify, be just, even if it concerns a near relative. And the covenant of Allah fulfill. You know, we can talk a lot the terminology of covenant in Christian life or in Christian theology and in Islamic theology. And this has he instructed you that you may remember. So this is a section in chapter 6 of Quran. And let's come to the Ten Commandments, and I try to find each of the commandments, which you can find in Old Testament, and try to find their similarities in Quran, basically. So first commandment, as you know, is you shall have no other gods but me. And you can find the same mentality, the same command in chapter 2, verse 163, chapter 6, verse 119, and chapter 6, verse 102, and also chapter 17, verse 23. You know, I will read each commandment, and because I will send these notes to you, you can check out and find out how similar or how Quran referred these 10 commandments and the interpretation of that Quranic verses. So you can find the second commandment also several verses in Quran. You shall not make for yourself any idol, nor bow down to it or worship it. The third commandment is you shall not misuse the name of Lord, the name of the Lord, your God. You can find in several or in some Quranic verses. The fourth commandment is you shall remember and keep the Shabbat holy, Shabbat day holy. So the only is not valid in Islamic tradition is that fourth commandment. Like in Christianity, the Shabbat day, the Saturday, the Shabbat day, making Shabbat day holy is abrogated in Islam. The fifth commandment is respect your father and mother, which you can find in different Quranic verses. The sixth commandment is you must not commit murder. You can also find in different verses. The seventh commandment is you must not commit adultery. Eighth one is you must not steal. Nine and 10 is related to neighborhoods or neighbors. You must not give false evidence against your neighbor. You must not be envious of your neighbor's goods. You shall not be envious of his house, nor his wife, nor anything that belongs to your neighbors. So I see many similarities or direct references to these 10 commandments in the Quran, basically. Then I try to figure out if I find a section in the Quran, what are the ground actions of Islam where I can find? And in chapter 17, Surah Al-Isra, in the Quran, there are several commandments to the humanity. And I feel that these are more universal actions rather than a specific to any people. So let me read them one by one. I did not get all of the verses directly. I just try to track the commands in this chapter. So I got into the verse between 23 and 37 and try to delve into the commands. So these are the commands which I could find. And your Lord has decreed that you not worship except him. And to parents, good treatment. And lower to them the wings of humility out of mercy and say, my Lord, have mercy upon them as they brought me up when I was small. And give the relative his right and also the poor and traveler, and do not spend wastefully. And if you must turn away from needy awaiting mercy from your Lord, which you expect, then speak to them a gentle word. And do not make your hand as chained to your neck or extend it completely and thereby become blamed and insolvent. And do not kill your children for fear of poverty. And do not approach unlawful sexual intercourse. And do not kill the soul which Allah has forbidden. And do not approach the property or an orphan, except in the way that is best, until he reaches maturity and fulfill every commitment. And give full measure when you measure, and weigh with an even balance. And do not pursue that of which you have no knowledge, and do not walk upon the earth exultantly or with insult. So these are, I call them as ground actions. You know, Muslims or people generally talk about five pillars. These are, I call structural actions, more rituals, but these actions which I mentioned right now are ground actions which you build the other actions onto them. So we have foundations, our beliefs, our faith, then a ground actions. Onto that we have structural actions. In tradition, it is called five pillars. So we can have a building, a complete building. So what are the five pillars of Islam? I mean, Father Badi mentioned several similarities between Christianity and Islam in terms of even in that structural actions. So a Muslim should follow, should practice five pillars, which are declaration of faith, daily prayer, almsgiving, fasting in Ramadan, and pilgrimage to Mecca. So let's start from the first one, profession of faith, or shahada in Arabic. So every Muslim should declare, should state that there is no God but God, and Muhammad is the messenger of God. So this is the beginning, is the first structural action, first pillar in the center of Islamic belief. So every Muslim had to state, had to declare in heart and with saying. And it is called the assertion of faith, basically. Second, several of you may realize how Muslims pray in their daily life. So Muslims pray facing to Kaaba in Mecca five times a day. And this, these five times has a specific time. So a Muslim has to pray at dawn, at noon, at mid-afternoon, during sunset, and after dark. So in these times, Muslims have to pray or should pray. And before a prayer is observed, ablutions are performed, including washing one's hands, face and feet. Prayer includes a recitation from Quran, several recitations from Quran, and it requires a series of set positions, including bowing with hands and knees, standing, prostrating, and sitting in a special position, which some of them may be seen in different religious traditions too, including Christianity. Muslims also can pray individually or together, and it can be prayed, the daily prayers can be performed at any location or in a mosque, and the altogether prayer in a mosque is more advised, more encouraged, but a Muslim can pray in their home, in their working place, in a university or on a park ground individually. And if it is performed together, a leader in prayer guides the congregation. So for example, even if we are kind of three guys and try to pray together, one of us can be the leader and can guide us in this performance or in this prayer. And the five daily prayers can never be waived, even for those not feeling well. They may pray in bed and even lying down. And it separates this daily prayer from the other pillars of Islam. You know, when you don't feel good, you should not fast. When you don't have money, you don't have to give alms. But you have to pray in every condition. Even if you are paralyzed, for example, you can even pray with your eyes. Of course, with some limitations, you cannot bow, you cannot stand, but you have to pray. You should pray within these limitations. And yeah, sorry. It is a photo from a man, of a man who is praying. And let's go to the third pillar. And it is almsgiving. Father Badi also mentioned the almsgiving in Christianity. And Muslims, yes, had to donate a fixed portion of their wealth. It is one of the almsgiving forms. There are several almsgiving forms in the Quran. And almsgiving is encouraged, advised a lot in the Quran. And some of forms are encouraged, and it shows the generosity. It shows the kindness of a Muslim. But zakat is a mandatory almsgiving. Every Muslim has to give this mandatory almsgiving. So it is a mandatory process, and it is a form of worship. And the amount of the donation generally varies depending on whether wealth come from farm produce, cattle, business activities, paper currency, or precious metal. And it varies between like 2.5% and 20%, depending on the source of your wealth. And the fourth pillar is fasting. During Ramadan, during the daylight hours of Ramadan, all healthy adults are required to abstain from food, drink, and sexual intercourse. So this is basic explanation of fasting. And in a month, during the day, Muslims don't eat, Muslims don't drink, and waiting for sundown to break their bread, mostly all together or with their friends. Muslims renew their awareness of and gratitude for everything God has provided in their lives. During Ramadan, they share the hunger and thirst of the needy as a reminder of the religious duty to help those less fortunate. And it is always a great experience for me, especially if it is close to the break-in time, because generally, we on our table have many foods, many drinks to eat, to drink, but you don't eat, you don't drink. And it shows me how we need Allah, how we should appreciate these foods, these drinks, how needy people feel, and how the obedience is a part of, should be part of our life. So it is the basic explanation of fasting in Islam, and Muslims is fasting 30 days or 29 days in Ramadan, in the whole month. And the last pillar is pilgrimage. So every Muslim whose health and finances permit it, must make at least one visit to the holy city of Mecca, right now in Saudi Arabia, during the 12th month of the lunar calendar. And they turn around a structure called Kaaba. It is a cubical structure covered in black embroidered hangings. It is believed to be built by Abraham and his son Ishmael for God. Muslims also pray toward Kaaba when they pray. So for daily prayer, Muslims should turn or has to turn their face toward Kaaba, toward Mecca. And this ritual consists of making journey to Mecca wearing only two white sheets, so all of the pilgrims are identical, are the same, regardless of their social class, regardless of their status or their wealth. And in each year, there are around 3 million pilgrims coming together in Mecca at the same time, though there are several quotas. For example, for Turkey, only 60,000 people can go to Mecca in times of pilgrimage. And my father and mother, for example, applied to go to pilgrimage about 10 years ago. And in these 10 years, they are just waiting their time to go to Mecca for their Hajj performance, pilgrimage performance. And a pilgrimage made at any time other than the Hajj season, but it is called Umrah. It doesn't call Hajj. While it is not mandatory, it is also encouraged or recommended. So let me show a scene from pilgrimage. So there are like 3 million people at the same time turning around this structure called Kaaba. So let me go back. And you see there are three floors in that masjid around Kaaba. It's called Masjid-i Haram, or the Grand Mosque of Mecca. So there are millions of people coming together at the same time in Mecca. I'm sorry why I did that. I should just. Yeah, so let me sum up at the end of my presentation. So the five pillars of Islam is the declaration, the daily prayer, the almsgiving, the fasting, and the pilgrimage. So these are the five pillars. And under that, there are ground activities which I named. And for example, love in Islam and in Christianity, in all religious culture, is an action. Respect is an action. Kindness is an action. These are not just values. A Muslim has to be kind. A Muslim has to show his love as Christians do. So I called them as ground activities and put these five pillars on that ground activities to build a whole structure or to have a whole building at the end. So this was my presentation for today. Next week, I will try to talk about the different sects in Islam. And thanks for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Fevzi. Thank you, Father Buddy. We have about five questions regarding prayer and Sabbath and confession, but one that's a little bit more general about rewards and punishments of Christianity and Islam. So are there rewards and punishments in Christianity if you don't fast or pray? Father Buddy, and then Dr. Fevzi.
So fasting can be, is very important. And but if the person, cannot fulfill that, I don't think the Christian would necessarily say that, automatically that God is going to punish that person. Nevertheless, we see that in more terms of a positive reality, that if the person does the fasting as a spiritual discipline, it will help the person. And if the person doesn't do it, they've missed out on an opportunity. So that's what my response would be to that. Yes, there's great reward in prayer and fasting and almsgiving. And if one fails to do that, then they've impoverished themselves. But, the punishment in that sense is just simply not having done it. And therefore, they're not as strong spiritual.
Thank you, Dr. Fevzi.
Yeah, the biggest punishment is hell, and the biggest reward is the paradise in Islam. And let me turn back and to show the whole building of Islam. You need a foundation. Without believing life after that, you cannot understand how big this punishment is or how big this reward is. But with understanding this foundation, this belief structure, you will absolutely see that how big this reward when you pray or when you follow the practices, or what will be the consequences in the afterlife.
Thank you. And then this is a question for Father Buddy especially. We used to watch in the movies when we were young about confession of sin in Christianity. Can Father Buddy give us more information about this, please?
Mm-hmm. Sure. It's one of the rituals of the church that where a person would go and confess their sins to a priest, and the priest would assure them of God's pardon. The priest does not see himself as the one who forgives, only God forgives. But the priest represents the community of believers, and the priest acts in the name of Christ and of God and declares the person's sins to be forgiven. And confession is, I used to say it was a very inexpensive form of therapy, that it is a way for counseling to take place for a person with a particular issue, perhaps, that they're troubled and they they would like to be rid of that problem that they have. They go to the priest, and the priest assures them of his support. And we feel that by the priest saying the words, "You are forgiven," that it helps the person to hear with their own ears the words, "You are forgiven," that that's important, and that the senses are important. And that simply to hear those words, "You are forgiven," helps the person to that much more appreciate the fact that they already are.
Why, thank you. A question about the Sabbath. How and when was the Sabbath abrogated in Islam, Fevzi?
Actually, Sabbath is abrogated with Christianity and Islamic tradition. It is the continuation of that Judeo-Christian religion structure. And Muhammad himself did not practice Shabbat. And in the Quran, it says that it should be practiced by Jewish people before Christianity. But with the coming of Jesus, it was abrogated.
What does the term abrogated mean? I don't quite understand the app.
It was a valid or practical prayer, practical form of worship for a nation. And Jesus was the person who had the ability to change the rules of the religion. And one of the rules that he changed was the Shabbat prohibition. Basically. So
Father Buddy,
practice became invalid or impractical.
Thank you. Father Buddy, would you care to elaborate on that and talk about how Christians do the Sabbath?
I would think that, for the Christian, the first Christians were Jews and they continued to observe the Sabbath. But by very early on, the Christians had moved the day of worship to Sunday, the day of the resurrection of Christ. There's evidence of that from writings in the second century that in Rome, anyway, they were worshiping on Sundays. And for Christians, particularly for Roman Catholics, it's a very important obligation to go to worship on Sunday. And that the notion of that is that communal prayer is very important. And I wanted to ask Dr. Fevzi too, that in Muslims, it's important as well to have communal prayer. It's just not the same day, right? Because in Islam, you go worship on Friday, or at least there's a sermon on Friday, correct?
Yes, on Fridays, Muslims have to come together and for a communal prayer, but Shabbat prohibitions are a little bit different than the holiness of a day or a communal gathering day. Absolutely, Friday is a communal gathering day for Muslims, and Muslims come together, pray in the same area in each Fridays. But like I said, it is the form of the day is different comparing to Shabbat.
Thank you. Is there a recommended or required length of time for prayer? Both of you?
In Christianity, there's no specific time applied to prayer. You can pray. It can be very brief and can be very plaintive as a person is saying, "God help me," if something is going on or you're in very dire circumstances. I recall in the Gospel of St. Matthew, when the apostles feel that they're drowning and Jesus is calming the storm, they say, and he's asleep, they say, "Lord, save us." Nevertheless, there are also very long prayers and very long even chanted prayers and in the Christian tradition. So I think it depends upon the circumstance, the setting, and the mood of the individual who's praying.
Thank you. Tepsi?
Actually, if you are talking about general prayer, no, there is not specific time or place. And in Quran, there is a verse saying that they pray when they are laying down, when they are woken, you know, when they are doing everything in their daily lives. But if you are talking with that, the salah, I mean, the daily prayer, yes, there are specific times it should be performed. For example, the noon prayer right now, I should check out my calendar, but basically it should be prayed between 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. In between these times, you have to pray the noon prayer. In afternoon prayer should be prayed between 4 and 7 p.m. And it changed in years because all of the times are based on the position of sun. So not a specific time. So you have to check your calendar and to figure out at what time or in which times I will pray. And for other worship, there are also some specific times. For example, you can fast every day. I mean, in many times, there are some prohibited days, but in many times, but the Ramadan fasting should be in Ramadan, in a month. You can go to Mecca, and it is encouraged in many times, but the Hajj is limited with a specific time. So I can say that yes, in that terminology, and no, if you talk about general prayer.
Thank you. I unmuted everybody, and you can unmute yourselves as well and chime in with questions. We have just about two or three more minutes. Here's a next to the last question. In Islam, we're told that see if I can get it. Muslims fast to learn empathy and understanding for people without food. Do Christians have a similar understanding, Father Buddy?
it's funny, when I speak during Lent, I frequently quote an Islamic poet, Rumi, who said that when a person fasts, they become thinner and they become more like a reed instrument, like the ney, and that God can utter his infinite music through us. That yes, there is in fasting to avoid food, it puts one in solidarity with the poor. One feels the pangs of hunger of those in need. And thus we become more compassionate.
Thank you. And a final question was emailed to me earlier today from Earl in the Midwest. Earl, are you able to ask that question again, or I can ask it in general, and then we can ask for a follow-up. Would you care to ask your question, Earl, about marriage?
Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
It was a simple question based on my experiences with friends in Turkey, where for a marriage to take place, that there was I assume sort of a private, actual, official marriage. And then later, because I went to a celebration one time and my friend said, oh yeah, they were married like a week ago or 2 weeks ago. And I was wondering if that has any foundation in Islam or if that's just Turkish culture. And I was told that it's mostly a cultural thing, but it's not an Islamic tradition, or it's not an Islamic rule.
Thank you. Fevzier or Buddy, would either of you like to comment briefly on cultural practices versus the basic and essential nature of religious practice?
I mean, for an outsider, I can easily say that it is not easy to separate, even for an insider, it is not easy to separate the cultural actions and the religious actions. And sometimes there is, if you don't read carefully, or if you don't read, you can easily be misguided. You can act like many cultural activities as it is religious activities, or vice versa. So for me, it is important because right now when I look to the actions in many in the daily lives of Muslims, I see that there are too many cultural orientations, and it was understood as a part of religion, which is not. So it is one of my purpose to read and to learn which one is religious activities. And for American Muslims in the future, I'm sure that American culture also will be part of their daily life. And it will be different than Turkish Islam or Pakistani Islam or the Islam in another culture. And it is not bad. It is how universal is the religion, how it should be. And if it is not kind of, if there's not any limitation with this culture, for example, Thanksgiving, celebrating Thanksgiving is not a common cultural activity in Turkey. But here we can come together with friends and we thank God in that day. It is a cultural activity. It is not part of Islam, but there's not any contradiction with Islam. So in the future, it may be part of American Muslims or the activities of American Muslims.
Thank you. Father Buddy?
I was just the one that when you talked about the how culture shapes, when Christians get married and they exchange vows in the Catholic Church or the Protestant churches, maybe they don't realize that, but that is a cultural addition to the Christian faith of exchanging vows between spouses in front of a minister. That goes back to European culture, as in the early Christian church, the priest or bishop gave a blessing to the couple and they did not have vows. And this was a clear example of a cultural practice that was pre-Christian that became adapted by the Western church as it moved into Europe. And so there's a cultural, I think it has become enshrined as part of our worship, though originally in origin it was cultural. So that's an example that I was thinking of.
Thank you very much. I hate to say that it's time for us to say goodnight. Our time goes very quickly, and it's a blessing to be together, as always. So thank you for joining us. And we look forward to seeing you next week for a discussion on sects, S-E-C-T-S. Sects, I guess, within Christianity and within Islam. Earl sent his question to me by email. And if during the week you have follow-up questions or thoughts or comments you'd like to pass on to Fevzier Buddy, please do so. We will be opening the waiting room at 6:15 next week. And we invite people to come on in and talk and discuss until just right before we start. So in the meanwhile, thank you very much for being with us. God bless you.
Thank
God
you.
Bless us all. And have a good evening.